So in this communication, which is titled Under the Waves, Geoarchaeology of the Tsunami that Destroyed the Fluvial Port of Roman Hispalis, this is the modern city of Sevilla, Spain, we will contextualize first the city of Roman Hispalis in its regional and temporal context, that's it, the southern Iberia in the 2nd century AD. This will be a frame from which explore the archaeological problem of destruction of the public building identified in the excavation carried out in the Patio de Banderas. Since its discovery, it has been hypothesized the occurrence of a tsunami as responsible for its destruction. The only evidence from this process is the stratigraphic sequence, so it is convenient to explore the geoarchaeology of the tsunamis. How can they be identified from the sedimentary point of view? With this background, we established a multi-proxy approach which resulted in the high-resolution microstratigraphic analysis. And finally, we will explore the archaeological implications of this study. Hispalis was one of the main Roman cities of southern Spain. It was located on the Guadalquivir river mouth. During antiquity, the river terminal system fell into an interior sea called Lacus Ligustinus. During the 2nd century AD, it was composed of tidal channels which allowed large merchant ships to arrive into the city of Hispalis. This city had a great suburban port composed of public buildings that was uncovered on the excavations of Patio de Banderas, which is in this point here, as part of the suburban fluvial port. This location provided a complete sequence from the 9th century before Christ to the 13th AD. The most outstanding construction is a building marked in red in this cross section here, which corresponds to a public building constructed in the 1st century before Christ in the time of Caesar. It had two floors and an internal courtyard, all made in opus africanum. This building showed a great collapse from the direction of the river. If you see this wall here, it's totally collapsed to the interior part of the building. This destruction layer was sealed by multiple siltial sandy layers which are great content in broken shells. Also, a chaos of stones and architectural decoration was integrated in this collapse. It is noteworthy that the typology of these materials doesn't correspond with the described building. For example, these kind of columns are not identified in the building we are describing. Also, there's epigraphy that is referred to an Isis temple, and this is not an Isis temple. So necessarily, they must come from an unknown public building that is in the surroundings of this one. The question is, how this collapse occurred? Was it really a tsunami? The southern coast of Spain is a very active seismogenetic area due to the contact of the Eurasian and African plates. There's a very complex fault system that provoked, among others, the tsunami of Lisbon in the modern era. Tsunamis, like that one of Lisbon, are recorded in the sedimentary record of the southern coast of Spain. A tsunami generated by a big earthquake in the sea floor produces several energetic flows. It is like throwing a stone into a pool. However, unlike normal storms, these energetic flows of a tsunami have a considerable wavelength from even 100 kilometers, which means 20 minutes between each one of the many different pulses generated by a tsunami. Also, these pulses have different energies. Four moments can be identified in a tsunami sequence, from which the second one is the most energetic one. Ancient tsunamis can be inferred from the presence of thrown boulders into the shore. But the main evidence of an ancient tsunami is the sedimentary record generated during the event. It is composed of finely stratified deposits in which sandy and silty layers interfinger, with exogenous lithological materials, riproclasts, and shells. The many different energetic pulses can be distinguished due to the presence of muddy layers generating in saturation conditions between pulses. Layers like these ones. A similar finely stratified sequence was identified in Patio de Banderas in the ruin of the public building. To decipher its origin, we studied archaeological sediments combining a wide range of techniques, as microstratigraphy, through micromorphology, mineralogy with X-ray diffraction, geochemistry with ICP-MS and ICP-OS, and microfossils. As a result, we can describe the sequence from the bottom to the top at a microstratigraphic level. So, what's out on the top of the pavement, microfacies 1, resulted from bay muds with abundant mollusks remobilization and sedimentation, as you can see in this picture in which shells are horizontally disposed. Microfacies 2, on the contrary, was deposited relatively fast and traumatically. Its sedimentary components indicate how the impact of the tsunami in the mainland and the Roman city provoked structural damages, because it is mainly composed of adobe, mud bricks, and also charcoal, big charcoals. Finally, microfacies unit 3 corresponds with water saturation, energy flow decrease, and definitively a relatively shallower environment of the first chain of the high energy flows. So you can see how it's produced a mud lamina due to the flocculation and the deposition of the fine material that is in suspension on the water. The second chain of energy flows corresponds to the position from relatively large waves in the tsunami wave train. So now we are in the second flow. Relatively coarse grain and thick sand microfacies are sometimes intercalated in the middle stage of a tsunami. Many tsunamis have the largest wave in this middle stage, and you can identify this because there's exogenous coarse mineral material in these layers. That's the situation of these microfacies, which corresponds with well-sorted calcarenite sand, rich in glauconite, and sealed coatings with microaminations produced to the water because of the water. This mineralogy, this lithology, doesn't correspond to the environment of the Roman city, but comes from the south. It is well localized in the basin and is in a very complete area, very different area. Again, sealing this deposit, we can identify a mud lamina, resulting from the suspension fallout of the core sealed clay and plant debris, reflected in very few pseudomorphic voids. It reflects the relatively long stages of stagnant muddy water between the second chain of the energy and the successive ones. Porosity indicates trapped air and airflow slipping upwards, as you can see in these planar voids connected by vesicles. This is trapped air escaping upwards. However, I will go further. It is relatively common in tsunami deposits the vertical repetition of microfacies and sedimentary units, because at the end of the day, a tsunami is a cyclical depositional event in which several waves are producing an input of sedimentary materials. That explains why we identify the same microfacies we saw below, but upwards. For example, this iron poor estuary marine sealed with abundant with shells. There's a difference. In these microfacies, the shells are not horizontally disposed because of the energy is higher. And now we see a vertical and a chaotic disposition of the shells in the microfacies. And also, after these microfacies, we identify the anthropogenical material rich microfacies with the mud bricks and the charcoals, and that is a repetitive sequence that ends with a poorly sorted sandy silts once the energy decreases and we enter in the third stage of the tsunami, and there's an intercalation of silts with mud laminae and some quartz grain microfacies, as you can see in these microfacies here. Finally, all this deposit is sealed by a mud cap, because at the end of a tsunami, there's a waning stage of energy decrease in which there's water saturation. And also there's a backwash of the water, and all that produces a thick layer of mud that seals all the sequence. And we identify this sealing all the sequence we saw below. Also, we can identify clay alluviation in these microfacies and pseudomorphic voids due to the organic matter decay. In all these microfacies we discussed before, we can identify several sedimentary components that comes from all these lithological units of the basin southern to the context we are studying. So a sedimentary event is depositing all these materials upwards, contrary to the direction of the flow of the river. Also, we studied the geochemistry and the X-ray diffraction, so the mineralogy, and all of them, they show statistically significant anomalies corresponding with the four stages of the depositional event. In these anomalies, we can identify the differences in energy. It is also, as you can see here, in the biggest stage of the tsunami, in which there is more energy, the anomalies are higher. It is also significant that during early Middle Ages, when there is fluvial and anthropogenic deposits, the geochemical pool is stable in comparison with the tsunami event in most of the cases, accentuating some anthropogenic inputs of lead and copper, as Rowena showed, that is very common in these anthropogenic environments. Also, through the ICPMS studies, we can identify geochemical discrimination of our samples, and when comparing the results, two different populations appear. When we compare silica with all the components we identify in the geochemical analysis, on one hand we have the tsunami samples, and the other we have the non-tsunami population, which is also significant from the statistical point of view, in which we can distinguish perfectly the two populations. This event has also been identified in the basin from a geological study that was published in two articles, and it dates from the same period of our study. Also, there's a lot of work to do, because there's a huge urban environment in the Atlantic coast of Spain. We can say that most of these cities have never been excavated, but that ones we know from the archaeological point of view show strong destruction events in this horizon, of the end of the second century and the beginnings of the third. For example, the Roman theater of Cordoba is destroyed, and all the urban fabric of Cordoba shows scenes of traumatic destructions. The entire city of Bailo Claudia is destroyed, and you can identify how the basilica, all the columns fall in the same direction, and see the aqueduct of the same city is totally broken. Also in Munigua, complete buildings fall down. So, is there a larger scale earthquake in the Baetica province at the beginnings of the 3rd century AD? Much work needs to be done. So, thank you very much for your attention.